All right, next phase. As we move from winter, from fall into winter, our training changes. The components of this strength hill phase include hill training. We advance the leg speed training, the neuromuscular training. We begin to introduce more what would be called traditional lactate threshold training. We begin to introduce goal pace training, and we continue to do racing and time trials. Again, we're still in a preparatory phase. We're still doing preparatory training to get ready for the real stuff that's coming. Hill training, which someone asked about, we prefer to do a Lydiard hill circuit. In the Lydiard hill circuit, the great thing about it was that you had uphill training, you had downhill training, and you had leg speed training. So the course they had was sort of a square or a rectangle, sort of half mile up, half mile across, half mile down, half mile across. So they would go up really hard, jog for a little bit, strides at the top, down really hard, jog for a little bit, strides at the bottom, repeat. We have a figure eight loop in Flagstaff that we mimic this. So we have a long hill. It takes about 2.5, 3 minutes for them to run up. It's a medium grade. Once they get to the top, they jog for a little bit, and then they do a stride. Then we have a short hill component. They jog for a little bit, up really strong the short hill, jog for a little bit, quickly down the long hill, jog, stride at the bottom, repeat. It's a 2 mile loop for our athletes. So we get good volume in, but yet they get a long hill and a short hill. The problem is that it's winter, and I live at 7,000 feet, which means it snows. So I can't do this in the winter. I can do it other times of the year, but not the winter. So we move to doing long hills. We have another hill. They say it's the hardest hill in Flagstaff, and by the suffering on their face, I think it's true. 2 to 3 minutes, 600 to 800 meters up. They'll do a stride at the top after recovering, jog back down, stride at the bottom, repeat. We also alternate that with short hills, these that last 30 seconds to a minute. Very strong, very high intensity. Again, a recovery, stride, recovery, up the hill. So we always include some leg speed in the hill training. We never just go hill repeats where we go up, jog back down, up. Part of that is because we're at altitude. Hills at altitude are very, very stressful. So I think if I had them do that, they probably wouldn't make the whole workout. We focus on form and power during these hill training. I don't care how fast they go up the hill. I only care that they use good form. I only care that they push hard against the ground, they have good arm action, they look like beautiful runners. That's all I care about in this workout. Obviously, you know, it builds leg strength, VO2 max, it challenges the aerobic capacity, and lactic acid tolerance, you're flooding the system, and it recovers, you flood it again. In the winter, we advance what we started in the fall with leg speed. So you remember 100 on, 100 off, 200 on, 200 off. This now advances to where we do begin to do some training 30 to 60 seconds now. So it gets a little bit more, a little longer, a little more intense. We still control this speed and effort. This is not all out stuff. This is still sort of in the stride zone. It's just for a little bit longer. We do, as a result, as we've learned, build up lactic acid. You can't run fast for that long without getting lactic acid. But we control it by the pace and effort they run, and also by how long the recovery interval is. You can always adjust how stressful a workout is by changing the variables, right? So if I don't want them to go too fast, or I don't want them to build up too much lactic acid, I just give them more recovery. So you can play around with these variables. We focus on running fast but relaxed. We say that a lot, relaxed. They're probably sick of me saying it. Run fast but relaxed. But that's why the good people look so good. They run fast, relaxed. You want to look that way. We work on that.
Are you doing these things in the winter?
In the winter.
Outside?
Well, we go down to Sedona for this. Oh. We're also lucky Northern Arizona University has a 300-meter indoor track, so we can do it there as well. So we're not doing it outside. This would be in a warmer, well, we're not doing it in cold weather, a little bit warmer.
Can I just ask a quick question about the hill circuit?
Yep.
Is the downhill at an easy pace, or are you going faster?
We go quickly down. Not hard, not to beat up the legs, and only on the long hill, not the short. The short is very easy down. But when I talked to Peter Snell, when I was with Arthur Lydiard, we had dinner together, and I talked with him. I said, you know, tell me how you did the hill circuit, because the coaches say one thing was the athlete, what did they experience? And he said he felt like the downhill was really the most important part for him. He felt like the ability to turn his legs over was important. Now, for our athletes, they're mostly longer distance. 3,000-meter steeplechase to the marathon is what our group focuses on. Not 8 and 15, though we race 8 and 15, but it's to help them as they go longer. So for the marathoners, that's good training for the musculature. I also think it's good training. Hill training is great because when you do hill training, you can learn what's your best uphill running technique. You ever written, you've seen articles, people write how to run uphill? Sometimes it's spot on with what you think. Sometimes it's the exact opposite. So I tell the athletes, play around with your technique. Learn what is your best uphill running technique. Same thing with downhill. Learn what's your best downhill running technique. It could be completely different than your training partner. That's okay. You just want to know what's your best downhill running technique so that you can be most efficient. Then you're ready for racing after that. With this advanced leg speed training, I do mostly it as a cut down, something where the repeat length gets shorter. Again, it's a way to keep them from overdoing it. So for us, we use a 600 cut down where we'll do 600, jog 200, 400 fast, jog 200, 300 fast, jog 200, 200. Does that make sense? That the speed doesn't get much, much faster, but I cut down the interval, the repeat length, so that they're not overdoing it. They don't get caught up in it. If we did repeat 600s, I know what they'll do. They'll just start trying to go faster and faster, and that creates a stimulus that I don't want at this time of the year. So I know the athletes and their mentality, particularly on the guys' side. I know they'll start one-stepping each other, and all of a sudden, might as well put bib numbers on. In the winter, we begin more traditional lactate threshold training. Steady state runs are what might be called a very low level lactate threshold run. Now we get into a more traditional lactate threshold training. I introduce it usually as progression runs. Again, I'm easing them into running this pace. So we do three types: fast finish progression run, the last 5 minutes at 5K to 10K effort. It's not too hard. It's definitely quick, but it doesn't kill them. DUSA, which came from Discovery USA, we did a lot of these. Last 10 minutes at half marathon effort. Some of our athletes haven't raced a half marathon, so we kind of give them some guidelines as to how that might feel to them. Should feel like a tempo run effort, right? If you think about that. We do thirds progression run. So we break the run into three equal parts. The first third is easy. The second third at sort of an easy medium pace, or that marathon or steady state pace. And the last third at half marathon pace. So if they're doing an hour run, 20 minutes, 20 minutes, 20 minutes. So if they do a 90-minute run, 30, 30, 30. It's a real nice way to ease them in. I really think easing athletes in is good, because they will have successful workouts. I really believe you need to have successful workouts. Set the training up so they'll be successful. Doesn't mean it's easy, but it means it's smart so that they'll be successful and build their confidence.
Just one, would you build that all the way up to the 2.5 hour range? The third, third, and third?
No. In this, we only go to 1 hour 45 on that.
if they haven't run a marathon before, what do you use for marathon pace?
We've done the steady state running in the base phase in the fall, and for that we try to tell them the effort level they should feel. And by that we say it's slower than a tempo run, but a little faster than an easy run. Now, when they first do the workout, they screw it up. And I tell them they're going to, but they always do. They go too fast, because you know altitude. They come to altitude. You don't feel it in the beginning, and then all of a sudden it kicks your butt. And we have a hill that's sort of in the middle of this steady state run. So by the time they get here, Coach, hopefully they have learned what that effort should be. We don't have a portable lactate monitor, unfortunately, so we can't know for sure.
Do you do it with heart-based
No, we only do it by perceived effort. We don't have heart rate monitors, and for us at altitude, sometimes, you know, on our courses, maybe they would have some. They go up a hill, the heart rate stays high for a little longer than it would at sea level, so we don't quite have all the resources we would like to have. This is a good way for us to be able to kind of get in another workout without doing another workout. So I usually do it on their long runs, and they like that, but I'm able to get in. We've not yet been able to successfully do three workouts plus a long run in our group. I've tried it, and it fails every time, so I don't do it. Now, most of them, if they came from certain colleges, are used to doing three workouts and a long run. And I have one guy, he was one of the Olympians, and I said, okay, let's do it. And he got sick or he got hurt. It's just too much stress for them with the way we sequence our workouts. So I'm trying not to be stupid. I don't do it anymore. So we do two plus a long run. We're having good success, so we'll probably keep it that way. But this is a way I can sometimes kind of sneak in another energy system being trained. The winter is also a time when we begin to do some goal pace training. This is goal pace for their championship season. So for them, it's U.S. Track and Field Championships, usually at the end of June. I begin in this phase, and we continue all the way to the peak races. It starts with very short repeats, and it builds to longer and longer over the five workouts. Now, this is five workouts over about 6 months, 5 months, something like that. In the beginning, in this winter phase, it's more to practice the neuromuscular feel of running their goal pace. It's not super challenging to them aerobically. For example, and I've broken it into, so these are our five workouts, right? One, two, three, four, five. For steeplechasers, these are the workouts that we do. 5K runners, 10K runners. So if you ask a 5K runner to go and run 25 times 200 at their goal summer pace, it's not that hard. They can do it. But it gets the neuromuscular going. Now, a month or so later, we say 13 times 400. That's not too bad either, but it's starting to get there. By the time they get here, particularly since we work out at altitude, this is a very tough workout. If they do it, they have a lot of confidence that they can run their time, and I know if they can do that, what they can run. On the steeple, the 1B, 2B, 3B, who's got a guess?
Barriers,
right. So we start with just one barrier on the workout, and then we increase all the way to 4 to 5 barriers. We never do the water jump, but we'll do hurdle work with them. I have a very good group of women steeplers right now.
Barriers per lap or total for the entire interval?
Per interval, per repeat. So one barrier in 200, two barriers in the 400 lap. That makes sense? 4 to 5 barriers in that one lap.
In the lap, not so 4 to 5 in 1,000 would be 2 per lap. It would be 4 on the lap.
Correct. So everything is transitional. So we're starting pretty far away from what they'll face in the race, and we're getting very, very close to what they'll face in the race. This workout is usually done about 10 to 12 days before their championship race. Really good for their brain. Really good for their brain going into that. This is what I've come up with. It's the distance of their goal race, right? they're running, if they're running 5,000, that will almost always equal around 5,000 meters. So they're doing the whole work. Coach Vigil mentioned the same thing.
Is there a reason that the steeple is actually longer than the race distance for the other two or
not? Yeah. Steeplers are tough. They are. And the steeple race is hard. Thus, they have to be tough. So having a little bit more challenge for the steeplers works better than doing it, because this, in theory, should be 3 times 1,000, right? Because they're racing 3,000 meters. But I find 5 is better for them. I don't know why. I'm just saying, like we all have to do, this is what I observe, and then so it works, so we keep trying it. The time? For them, in the beginning, that's about 2 minutes and 20 seconds. By the last one, they're kind of in the sprinter jog, so it takes them about 3 minutes or so. So 2.5, 3 minutes between for 400 meters. You know how runners are, right?
You said the fifth workout was 10 to 12 days before the big race.
Yep.
But I thought this was still in the only the second phase.
It starts in there. So number one, it begins in this phase and goes until the peak races. So this is done over the course of maybe 5 months, sometimes 6 months. So the first one will be in this phase. Am I clear on that?
Yeah.
So they're not doing all this in that phase, but they're probably doing the first one in that phase. We still race and do time trials, and it's really a great way to gauge their fitness and also prepare for their peak racing season. Most of us race better with experience racing. That's why we do these early season races, just to kind of get it going again. Remember the suffering. For us in the winter, we can do indoor track. We do some of that. Road races. Cross country, we have nice opportunities. They know going into this that they're not fully prepared for these races. And these are very competitive people, so you have to prepare them that they're not prepared. And there are some great races for us in the winter. People have seen the races at Washington on that giant indoor track. People run incredibly fast. We had a guy run 3:58 in a mile last year in the winter doing this. This is great racing. So, you know, it's a great opportunity for us to test our fitness, but they have to know they're not quite ready. It's maybe what you have to do in early season racing. You have to say, it's okay. Racing is good training sometimes, and that's the way we approach it. Psychologically, they begin to experience the same kind of mental effort, full effort stress. The hill repeats are extremely difficult. If you follow any of our athletes on Twitter, follow them on Wednesdays, and you will see all the tweets come out talking about their suffering. That's what they talk about. But this is a period when they can start getting calloused to running while they're fatigued.
Going back to, you know, the winter of racing, like you mainly focus on long distance and 3K, would you set up your racing shorter, like faster stuff? Like if the guy's going to be going to 3K and 5K in the spring, would you have him going like miles and 800 more just to get that extra bit of speed into their system?
So for our anaerobic animals, they're usually the ones that want to run track. They'll usually do the mile, something that's under distance, 3K, something like that, indoor. A longer distance people tend to go to the roads or do cross country. So it depends on the athlete a little bit. It also depends on what I feel like they need. The indoor nationals last year and this year are held in Albuquerque. That's at 5,000 feet. Wow. Is this to say I'm done? Thank you for coming. Please watch your step as you leave. Come on. Who's leaning on the wall? Slides are good. Maybe you don't need to see me. Maybe just the voice.
That can be your thing.
Yeah. Don't see me. Just hear the voice. It's like the Oz. We decide what races will be good for them. We have some athletes that we know will not race well at altitude. My sub-4-minute miler, you think it'd be great for him to go and race indoor nationals, but I don't think he races as well at altitude, so we won't do it. So again, you have to individualize things. Everything we do is a progressive challenge. Everything starts, it's very manageable. We never bite off more than we can chew. We chew our food 24 times or 36 times, whatever you're supposed to do. The athletes begin to feel tough now. They were excited in the base phase, team building, everything's coming, this is exciting. They do some racing. We won both national championships in cross country at the club championships a month ago. They get all excited, they're giddy, the team's great, everybody's doing well. Now they start to feel tough in the winter because they start to suffer like they do will in the spring. Again, if you look at Wednesdays, you'll see a progression. We alternate between short hills and long hills, and we do more repetitions as we go along. Monday is our variety day. You see we have a tempo run, traditional tempo run. Here's our 600 cut down I talked about, leg speed, 600 cut down again. You'll notice the long runs, we have some that are fast finish ones now. We still have some that are regular long runs. The volume, if you remember, this is the same guy. He was running 100 to 110 in the base phase. Now I came back down to his peak mileage from the year before. Now that feels easy to him. So we've done a good job. There's a lot of variety, and it's also progressive. 6 to 8 weeks long, this is our winter. And that gives you some information on there. This is important. I say it all the time, suffering. If you want to race fast, you have to suffer. You have to like to suffer. Training is about getting used to suffering. I don't think that's a negative. I think that's reality. All right, almost there. Once we get into late winter, early...
I have a question on that. Could you go back and talk about the pace of that 600 cut down again?
Yeah. So they'll do this at a 3K pace for them. And they'll end up at 800 meter pace, 1,000 meter pace. That makes sense? So my 358 miler, he'll start those at 135. It's not that hard for him. And he'll end the 200 at usually 25 or 26, something like that. It's at altitude, so maybe they're a little compromised. That's why I cut it down, so that they don't go too fast, too hard.